Good evening. Welcome. Thank you all for coming tonight. Welcome to this evening in conversation with Director X. My name is Cameron Bailey. I'm the artistic director here at TIFF. I want to thank all of you for coming this evening. I would also like to begin by thanking and acknowledging the Mississaugas of the New Credit, the Haudenosaunee, and the Huron-Wendat, who are the original keepers of this land. We thank them for hosting us today and for hosting TIFF on their land every day. On behalf of TIFF, we also want to thank all the people and the organizations that make what we do possible, beginning with our lead sponsor, Bell, our major sponsors, RBC, L'Oréal Paris, and Visa, and our major public supporters, the Government of Canada, the Government of Ontario, and the City of Toronto. This event tonight is also part of our Canada's Top 10 Film Festival, and for supporting that, we want to thank the Directors Guild of Canada and our media partner for Canada's Top 10, Now Magazine. Thanks also to all of our donors and members, I'm sure some of you here tonight, for supporting our charitable mission, which is to bring the power of film to life every single day of the year. This building actually never fully closes. There's always something going on here. A reminder, please place your phones on silent. If you know how to turn off your phone, you can do that too. That's always good. Many of us never turn them off. A reminder that taking photos or recording video is not allowed during the conversation, but we do encourage you to tweet if you would like, and the hashtag we use for events during Canada's Top 10 is See the North. And we will have a Q&A once we've been through the conversation up on stage here, and we will have microphones for that on both sides of the room, so if you've got a question, we just ask for you to wait for the mic to come to you. And with that, that's all the housekeeping, so we're going to get to it. You were listening to some of the music before we started, and you saw the reel of this man's work. So you know some of the artists he works with: Drake, Jay-Z, Rihanna, Kanye, Bieber, Cardinal Official, Diddy, Nelly, Aaliyah, Sean Paul, and did I say Drake? One man has been responsible for putting the image of all of these artists on screen. Over 20 years, one director has given the genius and the excess of today's hip-hop and R&B a visual language. In an era when people were saying music videos don't matter anymore, this man made music videos matter. The influences come from the dance hall and the art museum. The result is a body of work as a director that spans two decades and can be seen now all over the world. You can't go anywhere without seeing this man's work. For Canada's 150th anniversary, TIFF has just named the 150 most essential works of moving image art in Canada: feature films, documentaries, TV shows, and music videos. And on that list is one of the most watched, the most danced to, and the most memed videos of all time, Hotline Bling. The man who made that and so much more is here to talk with us about his work tonight. Please join me in giving a massive hometown welcome to Director X. Welcome.
Yeah, this is trippy.
So you got some fans.
Yeah,
here.
Good turnout.
That's good.
What's up, everybody?
You know, music videos are often made for the right now, for the moment, mm-hmm. the cultural moment that the song comes out in. But they have a history now. They've been around for about 35 years mm-hmm. In their current form. And your music videos are now entering that history. You're now part of the canon, especially with the Canada on Screen, the 150 works.
Yeah.
How does that feel to go to enter that world of the legacy of the moving image?
It's trippy. That's really trippy. Actually, yeah. I texted Drake that, hey, we're on the list. I mm-hmm. sent him the image. It was, wow.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, right. With the extra W's all at the end. You know what I'm saying? Uh-huh. Yeah, bro, that's a wow.
Mm-hmm. And you've come a long way to this point. You're Director X now. Used to be known as Little X.
Yes.
Before that, you were Julian from mm-hmm. Brampton.
Yep. Bramley and
Bramley, yes. Mm-hmm. Brampton in the house. Can you take us back and tell us a little bit about what made you the director that you are now?
I mean, if we go back, I think a good place to start is maybe the hip-hop era teenager. I'm drawing comic books. Well, I thought I was going to draw, like junior high, I thought I was going to draw comic books. And I start transitioning into this, into the world of hip hop, and start drawing like party flyers. This is my, you know, local party flyers for local parties, right? And that's the beginning, I think, of creating visuals for a hip hop aesthetic. And I start doing that. And then that, the growth from that goes into graphic design. I'm doing these flyers and I start getting really technical and it starts becoming graphic design. I start learning computers. So you have this.
Where did you learn to draw?
I mean, I just drew.
My mother, self-taught.
Yeah, my mother tells me the first picture I drew was of a television, so I guess that's perfect. Yeah.
Full circle.
I remember being in the doctor's office, and what I'd do, I'd draw these stick figures. Again, it's superheroes. You know, you're young, you love superheroes, right? So I would draw stick figures, but I'd do a color for the costume.
Oh.
And then I just remember being, and I'd do the sounds, and I'd draw lines, and I'm just, there were just giant computer sheets of superhero battles with lines. I remember this really clearly. So that, I kept on drawing, and that took me into comic books when I was in junior high. I thought I was going to draw comic books. That took me into graphic design through, again, through hip-hop and party flyers. And I was feeling myself. I'm like, well, you know, I get paid to do art.
So, 20, you are now officially
20 bucks,
an artist.
Yeah, right. 20 bucks for a flyer. I don't know if you can afford me. You know what I'm saying? That's, you know what I mean? So that took me through, but it actually took me down a path. So I was doing party flyers, and I did people's logos, and they got more technical, and I learned Corel Draw. And I mean, I back in the day, I came from print drawing the image, and then printing out, when I finally got to a printer, printing out the words, and then with an X-Acto knife, cutting them out, gluing them on, photocopying it at just the right level of darkness that you don't see the lines.
Right.
Like, serious, like, that's for the graphic designers are like, yep, yeah, I remember that. So I went through all these steps, and then that took me to much music. And then in between there, I started doing poetry, right? So I left home really young and moved in with my friend's place. He had like a studio.
Where was that?
The far reaches of Mississauga.
Okay.
Like Williams, Winston Churchill?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. So right there, so I'm sleeping in my friend's, he has a space in my apartment. They have a pre-production studio. We're rapping and making music, and it's just like, you know, I'm 16, 17, and I would write rhymes for my friends. Like, so every now and then I'd throw a few lines in, and I went to a poetry reading and read one of those things, which then brought me into a poetry world. So I was doing like spoken word stuff. So again, it's all hip hop related. The culture is still kind of reverberating through, and I'm drawing. And I do Much Music, remember Rap City?
Yes.
Right, so they did a poetry special. This is after, we're going deep into hip-hop history right here for the Toronto kids. So Michael Williams had just left the Rap City. He wasn't there. So it was that time in Rap City when they didn't have a host, but they were just like right at the bottom of the screen.
Okay.
And they did a poetry special, and I read a poem. And while I was there, I'm a young hustler. I'm like, hey, whatever. Dude, who knows Big C in here? Anybody? A few people? So Big C was the original intern. This is real hip-hop history. So Big C's on the scene.
People are taking notes.
Take notes. Big C's a dude on the scene. He's interning at Much Music. Back then, we didn't know what intern, so we all thought Big C was rich.
I'm an intern.
You work at Much Music. Yo, what? So he got a job. He went to BMG. So I knew there was an open position.
Okay.
So I'm there looking at the monitors. Hey, what's up with the Big C thing? Right? And they go, oh, well, blah, blah, blah. And I managed to work my way into Much Music as an intern.
Oh, okay.
And while I was there is when I looked at the cameras and I'm watching all these videos because I have to log things and all that stuff. And that's what sparked the interest in directing.
Wow.
Right.
And that's then, fantastic.
Yeah, it was a whole thing. And then Hype Williams comes along and then you get into the... Then
how did you meet Hype Williams?
Well, like I said, so I'm now... I remember it was like a dream because literally I woke up. So I'm now... I have an apartment downtown. I'm renting a room and all my friends would come like downtown. So I got 3-4 people, we're all, it's just madness is happening. And they're watching TV, I'm sleeping because I gotta go to school, and they wake me up, look at this. And I remember waking
You're
up.
You're still in school at this
I'm
point.
Still in school. So I wake up and then Flavor in Your Ear remix is on TV.
Yeah.
And this was like the first video, again, for the hip hop history. It looked like something. We just knew art, we just knew this was more. Right? It just the first time just the average kid was like, yo, what's up? There's something more going on. And I wake up and it's LL Cool J in a chair and the camera comes up and there's this girl's dancing and I go, look at that girl. And I fall asleep. Right? But then Hype just keeps on showing up And he was the first director. He's the first hip-hop director. Mm-hmm. He's the first name we knew. He had a hip-hop name.
Yeah.
And you could tell when he was involved. You could see this. Again, it just felt like art.
What was the difference? What did you see in his work that you didn't see in the others?
He comes from it. So Hype is from Queens. He went to the same school as LL Cool J. Mm-hmm. He's a real New Yorker. He's from where hip-hop started. Mm-hmm. So, but at the same time, he's an artist. So somehow this combination really made something that we understood. Maybe it's just an energy level, but the young hip-hop fan was like, this, like, just, why does that look great? Why does that feel real? Like, Wu-Tang Clan, Can It Be So Simple? Mm-hmm. Which you can still pull on, is still a piece of beautiful work. It just, everyone wanted their video to look like that. Mm-hmm. So Vibe Magazine did a story in the look section, and they did one pager on Hype. And I read that, I said, okay, I was going to do an internship. I know I wanted to intern and get into the business, so I took the address for Vibe Magazine, I took the writer, and I sent the writer this package of everything I've done. I had a poetry video that I had done with the help of people at Much Music, so they had dissolves and slow motion. This, again, this is back when editing for the consumer was two VCRs.
That's right.
All right, so for me to have this kind of stuff going on was like, who's this kid? And I had a t-shirt, I won't say a t-shirt line, I had printed some t-shirts, right?
You can call it a line if you want.
Had a t-shirt line. You know what I'm saying? So I sent the t-shirt, I sent the thing, I sent a little package of all my art and said, hey, I want to intern. And I sent it to three people, I made three packages, all right? And I sent one to Vibe and to the writer. And I called and I managed to get them on the phone. And it was Mimi Valdez, okay? And Mimi, I just had a meeting with her like last week. Yeah, Mimi now manages Pharrell. So she's one of the producers on Hidden Figures, right? So Hidden Figures, yay, Hidden Figures.
Yeah.
Black women in math, natural combo. So it is more than you know, isn't it? Anyway, so I call Mimi and I say, if I wanted to get a hold of Hype Williams, who would I talk to in his office? She gives me a name, a number, and hangs up on me. But I don't even know she hung up, so I call back, like, I think we got disconnected.
She's like,
she didn't pick up the second time, but that's right. All I needed. I had the number. So I called the number, and same thing. If I want to get something Hype, who do I send it to? They tell me who. And then I sent it to, I had a friend from Toronto that was a secretary for a director. I don't even remember his name. And I sent her the package. And then as I'm calling, checking up, we end up going on a trip to New York. So Cardinal Fischel had this offshoot of Fresh Arts. So Fresh Arts was this program for kids, an arts program. And look, a plus for that, almost all those kids, the majority of those kids that went through that program, the Fresh Arts program, especially Cardi's Maroon Squad.
Socrates, some other people came out of that.
On the radio, on television.
Julie Black came out of that.
Socrates, Cardinal. So really,
this is a government program.
There's a government program. Right. But it's good, you know, just like any.
Then it was cut.
But investing in your youth is a good thing,
yeah.
Right? And I'm here on stage talking this talk right now from this. So we go to New York on this trip, and while there, I go see my friend. She never showed the director. Again, the lesson I talk about a lot is people, when they see you as the guy who does art and poetry, they can't see, you're like, oh, it's a logical step to my next, and they're like, it's not, to them it's not, right? And people believe in themselves and doubt other people. It's life, so whatever, which is good because she's great, but the dude was not Hype Williams, okay? And then I call Hype's office, go, oh, we don't know. Okay, we'll talk to you tomorrow. Then I call one day, and I go, yeah, who's seen it? I'm here in New York. And like, what? Well, we don't even know who you are. We never heard of you. I'm like, let's put it there. We used to have debates with Def Jam about who was more ghetto in office. Is it Def Jam or Big Dog Films? Uh-huh. So I go, I figured out and get the address because I want my stuff back. You know what I mean?
Right. You're not going to look at it.
Just give it back. Yeah. You know what I mean? Okay. I'm about to come ruckus. And I get there, and there's only the office manager. Well, you're going to watch it. Someone's going to look at this.
Wow.
So
you are a hustler.
Yeah, man, I was 19. That's the thing. When you're young, getting your hustle on when you're young, you can keep pushing in a way that's cute and enduring that you can't later in life. You know what I'm saying? Being 30, like, you're going to watch it. I'm going to call the cops. So he watches it. Mm-hmm. He says, oh, hang around. I'm going to show a producer. And then Chelsea comes in. And again, Chelsea I worked with just recently on something for VH1, mm-hmm. right? And she's an in-house producer for Big Dog. And she watched it and said, we definitely want you. Like, no, another thing no one tells you is that the people you meet, you're going to know for 20, 30, you're going to know for decades,
yeah.
right, from a young age. Mm-hmm. So goes, oh, I'm like, I just want to work for free. I know this is good enough to work for free. Mm-hmm. And she goes, you're right. Come back in maybe a month, mm-hmm. and you know, we'll get this internship going. Mm-hmm. So I'm in Toronto. I come back, and I'm like talking to the mandem. So what's going on? Well, you know, it's like the music still, you know? More times, like, and I'm just talking to people like, I got to go. It just, the voice was screaming at me, right. Get out of here. There's yeah. nothing in a month. That, mm-hmm. So about 2 weeks, I go back. And the day I walk into the office, I'm a believer in serendipity. Mm-hmm. We'll have another, we'll talk serendipity stories. Mm-hmm. She was quitting that day.
Mm-hmm.
The day I walk in, she's quitting. And the executive producer, Kiki, looks at me and says, I don't know who you are. I have no idea what this is about. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay. And I just showed up the next day. I did a George Costanza. When you're 19.
Uninvited.
Uninvited. I came and started working. You know what I'm saying? And so, Costanza, baby, Costanza. So, but it worked out. But I'm hustling, you know what I mean?
It's a lesson for you all.
Yeah, if you're young, you can pull some certain things off. So I'm in there, but I'm like, I'm at the same time, I'm staying at my mother's best friend, my auntie. I'm staying at her place. But there's nothing, you know, they're grown, they got grown kids. Mm-hmm. I got this tiny little room. Always make your guest room uncomfortable. Uncomfortable enough that you can sleep but not stay. You know what I'm saying?
Right, yeah.
So I'm in this tiny little room and the only television's in the kitchen with like the, it's like an air, like there's no comforts in the home. So I spent a lot of time in the office. You know, they'll call my mom like, we haven't seen your son for days, but I guess he's okay. He comes, like I'd manage to come home. But I'd stay in the office and rearrange it. So when they, like, it used to be, so if this is the door, the desk used to be here, and people would just walk by the desk. Mm-hmm. One day they came home, and the desk is here, right? And you walk in, and now have to meet the receptionist, and there's chairs, and what happened? Oh, I moved it, because then I took the tape system that I learned at Much Music, and the tapes used to be in boxes in the corner. Then I said, give me I need a library thing and some stickers. And now it was, I need Wu-Tang, okay, CLE-095, and then you get the, and I just took the Much Music tape system, so like, we're keeping this kid.
You're organized.
I organized, and I moved up from internship to storyboards, and then working those relationships into directing.
I want to go back to a little bit when you were still in Canada, because you've been back and forth, obviously, for your whole career, but one of the first videos you made, coming up on 20 years ago now, is the Northern Touch video. And for a lot of us, anybody remember Northern Touch?
Hip-hop history.
We're going to watch this in a second, but I just wanted to talk a little bit about how influential it was to see Canadian hip-hop on your TV. Canadian references. It just felt like this is ours. This is not somebody trying to be American, but it's a Canadian video.
Yeah.
Let's have a look at it, and then we'll come back and talk.
Cool.
Northern Touch.
Yeah, man.
Nice.
That was our flavor in your ear.
That was what?
That was our flavor in your ear.
It was, actually, yeah.
It really was.
Yeah. That was, I mean, that was in heavy rotation.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about what it was like to make hip-hop videos in Toronto back then? Because hip-hop for a long time, by the music industry here, was not seen as Canadian music.
Yeah. I mean, you were doing it on shoestring budgets, of course. You had your little video fact grant. A few artists meant something. It's just a whole, I mean, now I'm looking at that like, wow. Just, you know, none of us really knew what we were doing. We all had a little bit of knowledge. But what it built in the Canadian filmmaking scene is that everyone's done everything. Right, so you're gripping on one job, and then you're like, just everyone's done every single job. It was this really great place to learn about this stuff, you know?
Yeah. it seems to me, just looking at your body of work, is that your rise was pretty quick. I mean, just based on the stories you've told, I get the sense that you were never happy to stand still, that you wanted to move up to the next thing right away. So after Northern Touch, you were immediately making a whole lot of other videos, and you were working a lot more in the States. Jump ahead a few years, and you're suddenly working with some of the biggest artists in the world. The next clip I want to show a little bit of is from a song called Excuse Me, Miss by Jay-Z with Pharrell. This is only 2003, right? So this is like 5 years later after Northern Touch. You were working with the biggest hip-hop star in the world. And Pharrell, who was just coming up at that time, but he was, you know, going to be, he was already big and he was going to get even bigger. So this is another level, superstar talent. Let's look at the Excuse Me, Miss clip and then we'll come back.
So randomly,
yes.
The jacket he's wearing in the helicopter is mine.
Seriously?
Yes. We traded, and then that gray three-quarter thing, I had that in my closet in Toronto since that shoot.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think I just gave it away. Wow. It was just some random stuff that happens on a shoot. I ended up collecting that.
You need an archive, a museum or something.
I mean, someone has it now. Someone in the 51 side of Toronto is walking around, probably Sherbin and Dundas, wearing that thing. It went to some Salvation Army thing.
Really?
But on a production note, whenever I watch that video, what I really remember, you know when the box is coming at you? We're in the online, and we're about to do that part, and I'm being too cool, like, oh, you guys got that, figuring they'll make something awesome, and I leave. And they don't do anything awesome. They just take the screen and push it back. So, again, it's like you can't ever leave anything. Huh. You can never leave anything. Every time I look at that video, I remember leaving too early, and not completely. And that not being done.
And it's just still getting.
Still getting, you know.
You're known for being very detail-oriented, for looking at every aspect of whatever production you're working on, hair, makeup, costume, cameras, lenses, everything. Is that why? Is it because every detail matters?
I learned from Hype. So what I really learned from Hype was that he knew every department, right? He could speak the language of every single department. He could talk to DPs, he could talk to hair and makeup. He'd be on set and say, oh, some, you know, the model girls wearing, oh, those are so-and-so jeans? And she's like, oh, they are. Like, he knew, he knew all this stuff from top to bottom, and spoke the language and got it. So, again, I was lucky to learn from a director who, to me, that's what meant being a director. You know all the departments. Being a director means that's how you become the director. You can speak all these languages. So when I went out and went to the bookstore to buy the books, because at some point you got to learn, hanging out ain't enough. Right, and I learned that. I hung out a long time. I shot a video. It was horrible. It crushed me. And then I went to the bookstore and had to teach myself. And some of the books were about hair and makeup.
Okay.
Right? So you got to know all. You have to at least be able to speak some of this language with everybody.
One of the things that you see in the Excuse Me, Miss video, which you've become known for, is that super ultra lavish lifestyle, the kind of the fantasy of the hip-hop world. The jets, I don't land at the airport, I call it the clearport.
Yeah.
You know, that whole bit with the car, one car for each day of the week.
Yeah.
You know, people have things to say about that sometimes. It's excessive, it's too much, it glorifies, you know, consumption, whatever it is. When you're putting that stuff on screen, because it's one thing to have it in lyrics, it's another to actually see the Bentley and the Rolls and the Lambo and all of that kind of stuff. What's your thought about what it means to show that in the work that you do?
I mean, look, this is really the world. Mm-hmm. You know, we didn't make Range Rover. We just discovered Range Rover. Yeah. I remember when the first time I saw a Range Rover was like when they were in that 4.0, 4.6 thing. Mm-hmm. Then I saw an older Range Rover, like, oh, these have been around a while. And like, when we grew up, Rolls-Royce was an unattainable, super rich car.
Right.
We didn't know that Bentleys existed and Range Rover existed and all these kinds of things. So there's been this secret kind of rich world that hip-hop knew about and spoke about and showed you. And so then you got into Cristal and all these other things. I mean, look, man, it's fine. It's not like, again, for hip-hop, I think we do get a little bit the subconscious race thing, right?
How do you mean?
Man, look, it's this black folks doing stuff makes people, especially America.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So look what's going on right now. It's 2016, and they're trying to dismantle Obamacare only because a black guy did it. You know what I'm saying? So there's a bit of that, and there's a little bit of, you know, how they get that-ness, and they don't deserve that. And there's all these little subtle, unspoken elements that I believe exist there. But hip-hop, what are you going to tell kids, man? What are you going to tell a kid who's literally from the projects, writes a song, and now has millions upon millions upon millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's gonna write a song about that too.
Okay. you have worked with so many artists, and before the financial crisis in 2008, 2009, music videos were kind of reaching a peak where the budgets were high. You could have, it seems like, almost anything you wanted to put on, up on screen. And you got to work with a lot of artists. I want to ask you first about that arc, because you lived through that whole arc of the music video from when they were fairly low budget, very high budget, and then the post-MTV world, essentially. So tell us first a little bit about that. What was that like?
I mean, it was big. Look, the first thing I remember, one, it's a bit about human nature. When we got it, we give it, right? So I remember Busta Rhymes and I joking about when we was entertaining, baby. We was doing everything. We was putting on a show. People were jumping out of airplanes. We're exploding. We was not playing games with entertainment. But on the other level, there's something to be said. How do I wrap my head around this? Just these big videos, and I was there. Like you said, I saw them grow. So the first video I worked on was like $100,000, and R&B group, and then LL Cool J we did for like $300,000 for Hey Lover. And that was like, they went to Miami, and they shot for 2 days, and we went and did a day in Philly, and then he did, so I'm right there as this is starting. Then the next video, I'm not there, but I drew storyboards for Down Low, R. Kelly Down Low, $750,000, they shot for 7 days. And then, hype shooting a video for Tupac and Dr. Dre called California Love. And then we get the tape back, and they built the Thunderdome.
Literally.
Yeah. And this was the beginning when things really began to jump. So, again, when we had that money, we was really trying to give people entertainment, you know?
And then when the crash came and suddenly MTV starts shutting down every outlet there is to show music videos, what was that like?
It was a lot of battles, and I often think about what could be done, and what if we put them on this, or we put them on that, and it's hard to move that system. So, we just kept on making videos.
This was around the rise of the internet as well, because people started to get videos not on TV, but on YouTube and elsewhere.
And everyone was trying to figure it out. And I think that was one of the big mistakes of the music business, was trying to shut it down, as opposed to embracing it.
Right.
But and I tell a lot of folks, so I had a meeting with some oil guy, and I explained to him the lesson. You guys have to understand, you're not selling power. You're not selling oil. You're selling power, right?
Right.
Because the music business, take the lesson from the music business. They thought they sold CDs, and they don't sell CDs. You sell music that goes on CDs.
Right.
So they're having this big battle to sell these CDs. Why are you making the CD? What are you concerned? Why? What are you fighting for that for? You should have been happy that you're getting rid of the hardware,
right,
and that
they're
you're just keeping
the plastic business or in the music business.
Exactly. So it's the same thing. But they had the music industry was the first bully to get beat up. You know, like there's this new kid at school, the internet. And the music business was like, "Give me your lunch." And the internet punched him in the face, knocked him out cold, and no one's been afraid of the music business since. You know. So yeah.
That's a great way to put it. I want to ask you, if you could, because you work with so many artists, I want to ask you to describe, just in one or two words, what they're like on set, what each one of these artists brought to set.
Sure.
Usher.
Focused, creative, collaborating. Those would be the things I would say.
Okay. You did a couple of videos with Aaliyah, including the kind of memorial for I Care For You after she died. What was she like?
Aaliyah was great. Again, family really comes to mind when you think of Aaliyah. Her mother's very involved, her brother's involved, her uncle, her cousin. There's a lot of family going on with her, really sweet. And it was an interesting shoot. We're out in Yonkers. There's two things I remember. One, there's a bunch of photos, because we're shooting that day. They're like, oh, she has to do it in-store. So we're in Yonkers, and like she goes to Brooklyn and does an in-store. But there's a bunch of photos from that in-store, because she's wearing the wardrobe from the video shoot.
Oh, okay.
So there's all these pictures that still exist of her wearing this wardrobe from that shoot.
Right.
And the other one I remember is we're in the hallway of the projects, again, in Yonkers. You got to imagine Yonkers is, Oakville. Like, it's far from the city. There's not a lot going on out there. And we're shooting this thing in the hallway, and she's sitting on an apple box, and some kid opens the door. And Aaliyah's sitting there, and they like have this little interaction, you know what I mean? But, if that's not that kid's story at every dinner party.
Yeah. Met Aaliyah totally by accident. Nelly, you did the Hot in Here video.
Yeah. I mean, Hot in Here, so Hot in Here is interesting. Nelly's really cool. he wasn't all in the creative like some artists are, but okay. he was a very different kind of star. He was the first real country mm-hmm. kind of star. And I just remember Hot in Here being uh-huh. its own bit of a phenomenon. Mm-hmm. And I watched it the other day. It came on randomly mm-hmm. on someone's Apple TV, and I laughed pretty hard at the roof's on fire joke. You know what I'm saying? I mean, when you're making yeah. it, it wasn't such yeah. a thing. Like, it wasn't a bad joke. Okay.
Hmm. Nelly Furtado, you worked with her a few times.
I love Nelly.
What does she bring to set?
I mean, Nelly's very much an artist, right? More so than anybody else. But the thing I actually really remember the most of the Promiscuous video is that I was having a real battle with the label over the edit.
Oh, yeah.
So much so that I took my name off. And this is when they put the name on the video. Oh. And so then the video is on TV. I'm like, oh, man, my name should be on this. Put my name on. And they're like, ah, screw off. We're not putting your name back. Hmm. And then since that day, I'm good or bad, I put my name on a video.
Yeah, you do. It's good there or, right at the, off the top.
Good or bad, mm-hmm. I did this.
Hmm. That's cool. You did a remix of the Destiny's Child Bootylicious video, the Rock Wilder remix.
Yeah.
Destiny's Child.
Yeah.
What were they like?
Super cool.
I want to ask about Beyonce, but I'm not going to ask about Beyonce.
But we can add, but it's a Beyonce question, let's be honest.
It's almost a Beyonce question.
Almost. I mean, it was a cool video. I wish I did some things different. But the real Beyonce question is, where's my CIA connect with the TIFF? You know what I'm saying? Go to TIFF's Twitter, and you'll see these guys research. Don't play games. Don't mess with TIFF, is all I'm saying. The research they do is not a joke. But Beyonce's in the Case video. There's a Case video, Happily Ever After, mm-hmm. and it's Case proposing to a girl. Mm-hmm. But Beyonce, this is with early Destiny, she was like 17.
Wow.
She's in that video. Huh. She's the lead girl in the Case, in the Case video.
You've known her for a while.
I've known since she was 17. We were, I was about 23. Mm-hmm. Like I said, the people you meet, you never know. Like, I'm 41
Beyonce
now.
Might be in your life forever. You never
forever
know.
Forever and ever.
You know just saying? Happens.
I'm saying, we have a deep connection, Beyonce and me.
Sean Paul, Give Me the Light, you did, and others as well.
Yeah, Give Me the Light was a real turning point. I mean, so at that time, music video budgets are large, 400, 500, like they had 100 grand. Mm. And in those days, you're like, we need more, you know? Mm-hmm. So, but at the time, I was listening. So my life is a little different with music because, okay, here's this one hip hop record, listen to it for days until you come up with an idea. And if you get the job, listen for it for days as you plan it out, and then edit it. So I'm listening to all this hip-hop and R&B mm-hmm. on constant repeat, and I'm not really listening to other stuff. So my own musical taste went really far. Like, mm-hmm. I didn't really listen to a lot of hip-hop albums. So I was doing, like, Billie Holiday, mm-hmm. and I was doing a lot of reggae. It got me back into my West Indian roots. Mm-hmm. So I think my assistant at the time, Patrice, she somehow connected with Sean and brought this job in. And all right, we'll do it. But as we're doing it, because at the time in New York, it was a big record, right? It was on the radio all the time. But no one was jumping on remixes, so it's a bit about the power of music video. Right. There was no Busta Rhymes remix. Mm-hmm. There was no, it was just this reggae record, a hot reggae record. Mm-hmm. And that story's going, but we're always saying, wait, because we're doing this. Wait, because we're doing that. And the label's like, yo, we're losing our heat because we're waiting for you so much. And then the budget's kind of growing. And then my manager, Taj, we went to another production company, and they're trying to impress me, so they really pulled out all the stops. Mm-hmm. And even in those days, that video should have cost $400,000, $5,000. Mm-hmm. Like, the Sean Paul, those sets are filled with lights, Kino flows, and they were all, like, we lit it and left it. And then when you watch the video, think about all that's going on there. It's a lot going on. Wow. So then we shoot the video, cut it, and put it together, and it becomes this phenomenon. I think they put on 106, they showed it somewhere and people lost their minds. It just had this energy and this whole thing and all this, you know, it's the first big video in Toronto that's playing. Everyone's dancing and it's just crazy. People, every time I show people, they just go crazy. And it naturally rose up the ranks of 106 and Park. And Sean Paul, even though, and this is still New York, suddenly now people are getting on remixes. Suddenly now Sean Paul is Paul. It wasn't until the visual came along that it went more than just a radio reggae record that will come and go, and now we had an actual star and all that grew from that, the power of great visuals and a great song when you put those things together and everything just connects right, and there you go.
You mentioned your West Indian roots. Mm-hmm.
TNT, Trinities, what up? There you go.
Now it seems very common to hear Caribbean beats, whether it's reggae or soca or dancehall, in North American music. But there was a time when that was a novelty, when it was rare,
yeah. right?
And of course, hip hop originally comes from Jamaican music, one way or the other. But it took a while. I think it was something like the "Give Me the Light" video that really helped kind of kickstart it. And now we've got Rihanna and so many others, including the last one I want to ask you about in terms of what he brings to set. Justin Bieber, who's also using West Indian beats as well now.
I mean, Justin's cool. Justin comes from a different beast. So for him, his manager, Scooter, really gets it, right? So when we're on set, I had him in a different outfit and a different car, and Scooter's like, no, wear that outfit, put him in this car. Scooter really understands what Justin is. Justin comes, he's just a good kid, man, at least at that time. I was right before, He's different. I was right before he went through his bad boy stage.
Right.
And I taught him this thing called the S, is what I called it at the time. So, well, if you push this small of your back and you push it forward, it puts you into a proper posture. Okay. So really, it's an alpha male thing we're in, right? So, but your body, like, just the very difference between that and that means a lot. So I could say hit the S. I'd say hit the S. And they would know to kind of stand up a little straighter. Mm. But by putting it to the button, because you know when you go to the gym and you have that pumped up feel, the S is that. And when you do certain exercises, that's your perfect form. Mm-hmm. So I gave him that. And I hope that wasn't what sent him down.
But I might have been what saved him ultimately.
Yeah, I mean, hey. I watched recently a bunch of Justin Bieber clips lately. And he's turning into a young man. It's a hard, I empathize. With being 15 years old and everyone watching you and adults making fun of you on like talk shows. Like it's a weird place to be. But now Justin will like, I saw something. He went to the boxing gym in like an Uber X.
Really?
By himself. Wow. The paparazzi's there. And he'll like look at he won't look at the camera. He'll look at you like, yo, what's up, man? Don't knock. Why are you knocking on the window? No, man to man. Why are you knocking on the window, bro? Chill out. And then he'll go back. Yeah, so Justin, listen, man. Justin might tap you up. Don't sleep.
We're going to watch a little bit of Boyfriend, Justin Bieber.
I'm still waiting for that experience.
What experience?
The parking lot, like in the parking lot where everyone dancing.
Yeah.
And like,
it doesn't happen as often as you think.
Yeah, yeah. It doesn't. Historians are going to have a real strange concept of our society. They would dance in the parking lots.
Don't believe music videos.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Not all real.
Yeah.
I want to ask you a little bit about what you started talking about in terms of Justin was, in terms of what he's gone through living in the public eye so much. And you're working with some of the biggest artists in the world who do live in the public eye. And sometimes what we see of them is maybe not behavior we would approve of. Mm. Can you and do you separate the behavior from the person, from the music?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. You get just understanding and some empathy, right? Mm-hmm. And just understanding how society works. And maybe because I have a bit of a perspective, I'm not some superstar. But I saw it, but I come back to a small town where, for a long time, I was the most successful hip-hop person. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Even though I was directing, it's like, you're doing it, right? So you're getting all this attention. That's a weird thing, and it changes you a bit. Then to get into someone like Kanye, like, you think, like what happens to, you're supposed to socialize dogs. You're supposed to socialize people. Like when you get moved out of the public element, and then you have folks who can't go outside, have normal conversations, or who knows what their team around him is doing, and it changes people. So if you can remain somewhat normal, it's a testament to whatever, you know, upbringing, however you want to shape that. But again, like, it ain't easy.
It ain't easy. On that question, I want to ask you about R. Kelly. Mm. I have to. I'm sorry, I have to. We have all learned maybe more than we would want to, honestly, about R. Kelly. You've worked with him a few times.
I have.
Same question. Do you separate the music from the person, from the behavior?
Yeah, I mean, I've never watched the thing. You know what I'm saying? It's weird. It's weird, bro. That's weird. But,
You're talking about a certain video.
A certain video, okay. An underground video he did. So I just didn't watch it, and I just dealt with the work. But interesting enough, he was in that moment, the stepping stuff. So what I did see happen with R. Kelly, he saved stepping. You really don't understand how serious this. So here you have this dance, an art form.
People know this Chicago dance.
Everyone was dressed in all white in my reel that moment, that's Step in the Name of Love. So stepping in Chicago is their style of dancing. It's their partner dancing. It's a whole thing, right? And R. Kelly does this Step in the Name of Love song. And we go and we're doing our casting, and we have, you know, we have real steppers, and then we have young people from Chicago. None of them could step. Hmm. Not a one. None of them came close. Wow. Completely in the dark. Hmm. The video comes out, big hit song. To this day, you put that song on, people do the song from the video. They do the dance from the video. Mm-hmm. Then we do it. He does another one. He says, "Oh, I'm going to ride this stepping wave." Mm-hmm. And another thing about kind of calculating art doesn't work. But it wasn't a bad song, but it wasn't a hit. Anyway, so he does Happy People. So we go back to do Happy People, and we do our casting. Every single young person steps now. Mm-hmm. The Chicago kids said, "That's ours." And they went back and reconnected. Mm-hmm. And they all just got back into it. And if it wasn't for that video, it wasn't for that song, it wasn't for that guy, mm-hmm. we actually would have lost a piece of culture.
Mm-hmm. You just gave me a great segue to another piece of culture. This will be a bit of a leap, so bear with me. Bar mitzvahs.
I know it's a natural connection. R. Kelly bar mitzvah, yeah.
So we've got a little clip from Start From The Bottom video, but you had done Drake's bar mitzvah video, and now you had him in Start From The Bottom in a Shoppers Drug Mart.
Yeah. let's be clear about my Toronto Canadian props right now.
Yeah, I mean, you get street, any more Canadian
I mean,
than
yeah,
that.
Shoppers Drug Mart, the Toronto football field, mm-hmm. the real jerk.
Yep.
I mean,
yep.
No one can talk to me about my Toronto repping at all.
Where do the ideas for Drake's videos come from?
Well, those ones were actually Drake. So when we did Started From The Bottom and Heifer, that was Drake saying, "I want to do a bar mitzvah." Mm-hmm. And he said, "I've been sitting on this one. I know that, but I want to do this." Mm-hmm. And it's interesting. Actually, I had that phone call. I had to go to the Def Jam to listen to Boyfriend. Mm-hmm. And then in that room, I took the call with Drake. Talking about Heifer. He was like, "Video," and he said, "Videos don't mean anything anymore, so I need to make it mean something." Mm-hmm. So I want to do this bar mitzvah. He really gets it. He gets himself. He gets what's going on in the world.
That is the first hip-hop bar mitzvah video, as far as we know.
The first hip-hop bar mitzvah video. Yeah, you know what I mean? So that with Lil Wayne in.
Yeah.
I mean, it was quite a thing. Just watch the video. You know what I'm saying?
it's a great video.
Yeah, it's mind-blowing stuff. So... But he got it. Hip hop videos don't matter, so I need to do. You need to do something that matters. You need to make something. It's not enough just to do pictures,
right?
We need to do something that's going to shake it up, and that was the step. Mm-hmm. And it was for Drake. Remember, till then, everyone kind of complained about his videos, and there was always a thing. And then this one came along, and it was
people
kind of electric.
Paid attention. You stopped and watched it. You couldn't help but do that. Let's look at a little bit from Started From The Bottom, and we'll come back. I love it.
It's fun.
Started From The Bottom. That is so Toronto.
It's very Toronto. It's a super Toronto.
I love it, including flying south to someplace warmer.
Completely. Completely. And then, you know, that shot of him when he's in the daishiki type thing, that's just me and him. Like, it's a tripod.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm like, we're kind of like both dancing as we, as I move the camera around. Huh. Yeah.
By now, this is 2013, just a few years ago. You've been doing it for many, many years, over 15 years at that point. And there's a style. There's certain sort of stylistic tropes that you see in a Director X video time and again. How would you describe your visual style?
I'm very graphic, right? Mm-hmm. And earlier in my career, it was also a lot of lines, a lot of color coordination, set design. The graphic element, again, coming from that graphic design background.
Right.
And it kind of resonated. It's like the Cardinal video, the old time killing, kind of became a thing for a while. People did that. And I did some split screen stuff for Fabulous, and that became a thing for a while. Mm. And it was very, very graphic for a while. I don't know what I would say now.
There's a lot of, you put dancing in your video quite a lot. There's a certain sort of, pushing forward tracking shots that I notice in a lot of your videos, the bars at the beginning. Mm-hmm. There's certain sort of things that when you watch it, you immediately know it's you.
Yeah. Yeah, I do the screen. Now I do this. It used to be that.
Right.
And that kept on getting jacked, so I stopped. I actually jacked the kid back. So you watch, So I watched this Jamaican video on this kid, what do you do? So this is when I was doing this one. Right. But every scene, he'd do this and do that to transition each scene. So I said, oh yeah? I'm putting that in the Usher, the R. Kelly Usher video. So that's my transition between every scene. Okay, yeah, I just he probably knows it's him. I don't know, some Jamaican kid. But steal from me, baby, steal from you.
Nice. We've got another clip I want to show, and this is bringing Drake together with Rihanna at The Real Jerk. Made me feel so proud. I'm sure a lot of people in Toronto as well to see The Real Jerk in one of the biggest videos of the year.
Like this I said, is, man, this you is can't work. Say nothing.
That's right. No, you
have put us. And the other thing, too, is that, I mean, I think along with Drake's music, your videos make Toronto look larger than life, you know, the scale of it, the aerial shots of the city, the CN Tower, the Gardiner, all these things. It makes it look like a big, dramatic place, which if you're just walking around and taking the streetcar every day,
might not be.
It doesn't seem so dramatic.
Yeah, right?
But you make it dramatic somehow.
Is that
deliberate? Are you trying to kind of amplify the city?
I really am a hip hop artist. You know what I mean? I think it's the best way to describe it. And part of that is claiming your town, waving the flag of your town. Mm-hmm. So I've been waving the flag. The first video I really ever did was Shaw Claire, What It Takes. And I got them on Toronto Island with the CN Tower in the background.
Right.
My generation was the first generation to really say, we're from Toronto. There's a hip-hop generation before that either avoided it or didn't bring it up.
Mm-hmm.
My generation, the Cardi generation, we're from Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Drake generation kind of watched that and grew up. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, a kid from Toronto is used to hearing someone put Toronto into a lyric.
Yeah.
You know
that's
what I mean?
Right.
And when I was growing up, was that T.O.? Was us? T.O. We talk about. I think that was rewinded because I think they're talking about us.
And so, yes, actual streets and neighborhoods.
And now it's a thing. There's all kinds of Toronto lyrics. So look at that.
Now what happened?
Yeah.
Let's look at a clip from Work. We have to talk about booty.
Yes.
Because it may seem, if you watch a lot of your videos, that you started from the bottom and kept going back.
Just stayed there.
Yeah. All right, so look, we know what it means in the music and the culture, but what's your take on why we see so many backsides in your videos?
I mean, so there's a thing. So hype, this goes back to my, hype told
me
to do it.
Please tell us.
But okay, so back in those days, so hype and Malik Saeed, this great director of photography, all our references are actually fashion photography.
Okay.
We go through these magazines, have books full of things we pulled for Vogue and all this stuff that we use as our influence for our work. So there's even this article, I think it was in when Vibe wrote, one of these guys wrote about me when I was in my 20s, said, yeah, X's booty videos don't feel like it didn't come from a grimy place. It came from art, you know, it's beauty in a body and the shot and the thing, and there's some sexuality to it, but it didn't come from dirty guys trying to get girls naked. Just we translated these fashion shots into that. And again, a little touch of race comes into the backlash. Right, it's hip-hop and it's black women, and they're more voluptuous, and they're dancing in a way, and it's all that. And then on top of that, you throw in the lyrics, and some guy talking about, be this, and that, and that, and I'm gonna, right? So it was a weird place for it to land, right? But on a larger scale, and the argument I have, that even for the people that argued that it's wrong to have a woman in a bikini dancing, that's inherently a negative thing, but why? Well, because if she's in the bikini dancing, then it's like arousing for men. Okay, so what's the problem? Well, the men are aroused because she's dancing. Okay, so the solution is she shouldn't be dancing in a bikini, not the men should control themselves.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I know what you're saying.
So,
I mean, the question is all often about, is that woman in the bikini dancing being objectified by the camera?
It comes from two different things, you know. Is she up there dancing because she loves to dance and comfortable with her body and not afraid? Is she up there dancing because some traumatic thing in her life makes her dance for the approval of men and hope? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's two people doing the exact same thing, but the root of it is very different. Because you find those two things are very real things.
Mm-hmm.
But that's, again, a separate issue from a female body being attractive to men, so it's her responsibility to cover it so the men don't do something. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Okay. This is a very separate. So even there's a segment of the argument that's pimp shit. You know what I mean? And what I say is like they game you, right? You can't this, you can't that, you know? And then it just gets in people's heads. So this religious stuff, it's just there's a bunch of, we're a Puritan society over here. Mm-hmm. Remember, the people that came here were trying to get away from European liberal back in the 1600s, mm-hmm. 1514, 1517, right? And coming over here and burning women at the stake. And there's, you know, women couldn't wear pants until, our society has a deeply ingrained fear of women, which really comes from a fear that your woman will go find another man.
Well, in the work video, you're especially bringing in West Indian dance, African dance, black dance mm-hmm. forms, which are the opposite of what you're yeah. just describing in terms of that Puritanism. And one of the things I've read you say in terms of commenting on dance and how sexual it looks is that it's just dance.
No, completely.
It doesn't necessarily mean that there's a sexual relationship.
Right.
People can separate dance and sex.
Completely. Look, it's the dance itself is a battle, mm-hmm. right? A West Indian knows if you go up behind a girl and you're trying to whine with her and you can't whine, she's gonna walk off. This is a
proven
dance.
Fact.
It's proven fact.
Yes.
It's a dance, and then there's levels of. I joke that a Trini wine is illegal, right? Trinidadians dancing could get you arrested in certain states. So, but again, it's just a dance. I went to a carnival party with my friend, and he's dating this like Persian Jewish girl, and so she comes to the thing, and there's a girl dancing and it's moving. I walk up behind her and I give her a dance, and then we walk away. We never speak. I don't think she even turned around, and she's like, "What happened? What was this? Like, what is this strange world, you guys?" It's just a cultural thing. So that's even for Americans, dancing mean you're together,
right.
And it's just their culture, and this even black culture. I went to a party, after party for some award show, and I bumped into some, you know, like a reality show famous girl, mm-hmm. and we've danced together at parties, like just dancing. Mm-hmm. So we're there, and one of my tricks, if the girl's shy, I say, dance behind me, and then we can have that groove. Mm-hmm. So she gets behind me, we kind of get into our mode, and you felt all the heads go, whoop, and we had to stop. Mm-hmm. Because dancing in that society isn't dancing. That means there's a relationship and da-da-da-da-da-da-da, right? And we had to kind of just, we're not uh-huh. in a place that gets it.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
tell me about your choreographer that you've worked with a lot, Tanisha Scott, mm-hmm. what she brings to your videos in terms of dance.
I mean, Tanisha's just really authentic to this culture, right? She, we almost forced her to choreograph Give Me the Light. Yeah. Like, you have to do it. And it is this authentic understanding. Like, the culture is in her, her ability to dance, all these things. And she's in Give Me the Light. That's who I dance with in Give Me the Light. And that is who Drake dances with in Hotline Bling, recreating the Give Me the Light moment.
Oh, right.
Yeah, he's like, I'm going to do that Give Me the Light thing with you guys. So,
and she's from Toronto. Originally.
She's a Toronto girl, man. Mm-hmm. Like, just, again, a dancer who just danced. She didn't go to school. Mm-hmm. It wasn't taught to her. She just dances. Mm-hmm. And, it's hip-hop.
Mm-hmm. So you've made over 50 music videos, but last year you also did something new, which was a feature film called Across the Line. I want to talk a little bit about that as well. This was a film that was set in Atlanta, Canada, premiered at the Atlantic Film Festival, won the best Atlantic Feature Prize there, and it's about hockey, which is almost like the reverse of hip-hop.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we have a clip from Across the Line. I want to watch a little bit of that and
sure.
then we can talk. That's Stephon James. He was actually a TIFF Rising Star here a couple of years ago. He was in the film Race playing Jesse Owens.
Yep.
You're going to see a lot more of him.
And his brother Shamir Anderson.
That's right.
Yeah, he's in the Johnny Depp movie. I just saw him in L.A. He was very excited. He just got off set with Johnny Depp.
Oh, cool.
Oh, yeah, baby. So we got some real talent.
Hmm. You've done everything that you could possibly do in music videos. What drew you to making a feature film?
I mean, I've wanted to tell stories, really looking to tell my own stories as well, not about me, but my full creative work. Music videos, I'm making visuals for other people's words.
Mm-hmm.
So to go into spaces that I find interesting and do that. And then this one, which was fitting, it's about Nova Scotia, the oldest, largest black community in Canada, North Preston. You know, You got folks who've been there since the 1800s. Their family been there since the 1800s. Mm-hmm. There's a church. One of the opening shots is a church. It says established in 1830-something. You know, so this is a story not a lot of people know of. And in 1989, Cole Harbor High School got into this big fight. You know, like, it's hard for us to imagine a completely homogenous area in Canada because everything's so multicultural. We look around the room right now, we're from Toronto. Mm-hmm. But North Preston, you got kids, especially back then in 89, mm-hmm. the first time they saw white people was high school, right? North Preston is at the end of the road, at the end of a road, at the end of a road. You're not going to North Preston unless you meant to go to North Preston. Mm-hmm. There's no passing through. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when they say, oh, the Underground Railroad led to Canada and the slaves were forever free and happy. Well, this is where they went. So these are the descendants of the Underground Railroad. And so they get these kids that have never seen, live in this homogenous black neighborhood with all the stuff that comes with having a black neighborhood off in the distance. You went to North Preston. Did they? You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And then they go to school and there's another neighborhood called Eastern Passage, which is working class white, and they've never seen anybody till now. And you... Mm-hmm. put them all together in high school.
Right.
And it kicked off into like a 70 to 100 person riot mm-hmm. one day, and just massive. So the writer Floyd Kane and producer was there when that happened, and this is all influence from that event.
Hmm. Amazing.
Yeah.
I wanna ask you something I've always been a little bit curious about. So there is a whole infrastructure for filmmaking in Canada, which has to do with film schools, arts councils, Telefilm Canada mm-hmm. funding, distributors, broadcasters, film festivals. You mostly brushed all of that aside, and you carved out your own career completely separate from that. Why did the existing system not support someone like you?
I don't know. I really don't know. I really don't. You know, I've been since the 2000s on, from 99, I've been doing music videos, they're getting a lot of play. Maybe it's just not people having their finger on the pulse of what's going on, mm-hmm. disregarding what hip hop, I don't know what it is. Yeah. Right. It happens how it happens. You notice in Canada, there's some artists that work through the system and, mm-hmm. and it works for them, but it works in like a Canadian. Have you ever noticed like the Canadian artist that is a big Canadian artist never quite crosses over, mm-hmm. but the Canadian artist that crosses over themselves and becomes big, you know what I mean?
Right.
So it's interesting.
Is that system of any use to you now? Do you need it in any way?
Yeah, I mean, like, they make movies, they make, you know, I'll work with who there is to work with, and now there's some interest, but, I'm very thankful, because mm-hmm. My first video was a Video Fact video, okay. right? And there was mm-hmm. a time, to say that the whole system didn't back me wouldn't be true. There was a time Video Fact, it felt like, would give me any job that I submitted to them. Mm-hmm. So that end of the game really worked. So, you know, whatever, there's a bunch of paths that lead to the same place.
Sure. In addition to branching out into feature filmmaking, you're also doing visual art installations. Mm. Now, you did something very impressive at Nuit Blanche just this past year called Death of the Sun. We've got a photo, I think, of it for those of you who weren't there. It's this giant orb lit. Can you tell us a little bit about what the idea behind this was? This is right in Nathan Phillips Square.
So, you know, Nuit Blanche is... We all know Nuit Blanche, and they came to me and said, we want you to do something, mm-hmm. and they said, you got Nathan Phillips Square. Mm-hmm. And then my creativity, now being a professional artist, $20 a flyer, by the way, but my creativity gets engaged by the, like, oh, here's a job, and then mm-hmm. I go. So you got this space, come up with something, and I thought of a few things. At one point, I was like, what if I made a giant transformer? Or what am I going to do? And then I said, oh, I want to do the solar system. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to do the big idea with that you go and there'd be this sun at Nathan Phillips Square, but then you go around the city finding the planets. Mm-hmm. And the city was like, no, you don't. you get Nathan Phillips Square. Right. It's enough. Which, again, if you embrace the difficulties, it gives you better art. Mm-hmm. Right? Because just going to Nathan Phillips Square and watching the sun, what am I looking at? Mm-hmm. So the death of the sun, as I was researching the sun and its life cycles, became what it was. Because what mm-hmm. I wanted to do was I want people to see the sun and then see the earth in its size. And then mm-hmm. we all say, that's us. Mm-hmm. We're all, especially in this city, we're this big multicultural city, every race, every nation in the world is here. And we look at the earth and say, that's us, that's our earth world. And then hopefully we'd all hug and cry, and world peace would ensue, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, that didn't happen, so it didn't happen. But anyways, the death of the sun still kind of it has that. It goes through these stages in the sounds of the sun that we're playing, but it's still hopefully that was the bigger piece. It's a humanity. It's about us. Even though making about the sun, that's our sun.
Okay.
Or we all look at it and say that's ours. Hmm. You know.
And you can also see your interest in light here as well, and that leads me to where we first started talking in terms of this night, which is the Hotline Bling video, and the light in that video is just so remarkable. One of the influences, I'm told, is the visual art of James Turrell, and these kind of lit spaces that he makes. What I want to do, and I don't know how well this will work, but what I want to do is I want to play the whole video through. We'll start out with full volume. I think we all, has anybody here not seen Hotline Bling? No. let's start it off the top. We'll play the sound for a while. You can sing along if you want to. You can dance if you want to. And then we'll bring it down. I want to talk a little bit about some of the details as well. Yeah, okay, so let's watch Hotline Bling.
I've played with feet before.
No, you have a big
I love feet.
No, I like feet.
No.
Saw
the toes on the
other No. No, maybe I'm not going to
say love to do that for you.
You used to call me all night. You used to. Yeah. You used to call me on my cell phone. Late night when you need my love. Call me on my cell phone. Late night when you need my love. Hey, I know when the hotline bling, that can only mean one thing. I know when the hotline bling, that can only mean one thing. Since I left the city, you got a reputation for yourself now. Everybody knows and I feel left out. Girl, you got me down, you got me stressed out. Cause ever since I left the city, you started wearing less and going out more. Glasses of champagne out on the dance floor. Hanging with some girls I never seen before. Call me on my cell phone. Late night when you need my love. Call me on my cell phone. Late night when you need my love. I know when the hotline bling.
All right, let's bring it down. Thank you. You know, as I'm watching this, I'm thinking this is kind of your Citizen Kane. This is where everything is here.
Yeah.
There's a lot of detail, but it's so compressed. So talk to us first about, there's a kind of a story here, there's a narrative in terms of the hotlines, the phone lines. But then there's also this incredible dance that became memed all over the world. So what were the component parts for you as you were putting this together before you shot?
I mean, so part of doing a performance video is having the visual, like what is this about, essentially. Mm-hmm. So this is about these lights and these spaces and in these sets that you're making a stage for them to perform on and let them do what they're gonna do, right? So it's just go, right?
So it's not choreographed, you set the stage and you just say,
and
go.
Right, and you let him dance, you let him perform. And you have a guy that's been traveling the world on stage by himself, dancing around, doing shows. Mm-hmm. So, this is him letting loose and bringing some of that to the whole piece. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So when I was watching, did you think the dance was? I'm just happy to see men dancing. I think it's something in our society. The women will agree, I'm sure, that men not dancing is really right. There's the nodding heads. You go out and there's women dancing and the men stand around. Mm-hmm. Or and the most painful thing for me is to be somewhere and you see this girl. She's dancing with her boyfriend and her boyfriend's just.
just something,
bro. Just two step. You know, I'm just like, come on, you can do it.
In addition to the fact of a man dancing, he's wearing all of these clothes that just seem kind of softer than you usually get from these hard hip hop. He's wearing a sweater, for God's sake. You know.
Yeah.
And that became a whole thing as well. Like, yeah. That's the sound of Drake persona. He's vulnerable.
Yeah.
He's a sensitive man. Was that all conscious?
I mean, that's him. Like, the thing about, especially nowadays, artists kind of come as is. So you're setting a stage for them and let them go. And you might have a word here and there, but a lot of times they're going to do what they're going to do. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's him. All right, you're wearing that? Let's go. You know what I'm saying? And
this was one of those gifts. I think we've all seen the one with the racket.
And yeah, and the lightsabers. My favorite one is the lightsaber one. I love the lightsaber one.
I mean, when you're shooting that kind of thing, do you know that it's going to be that?
No.
That it's no.
I've removed myself from any kind of. I'm not that dude. I can't. I've come to think there are some people who can kind of speak things into existence, and some can't. Mm-hmm. And so I don't. I'm very superstitious. I'm super West Indian. I don't. I'm knocking on wood. I just this is going to be a hit. I'm kind of like the universe. Like, no, it's not. Now it's not. Uh-huh. But then I always remember Donald Trump, who does a parody of this. Have you seen the Saturday
Seriously?
Night Live?
No.
There's a Saturday Night Live parody of this with Donald Trump.
Oh, God.
So how about that? dancing in the video. But I remember when he came out for his for the convention, he comes out and he looks at the crowd and goes, oh, we're going to win. We're going to win. And I think some people just kind of have that. They can talk it in. Hmm. So, but I don't do that. I don't predict anything. Mm-hmm. I find my spot is good when I just focus on the art and the craft and not try and calculate. So, if I make colors, people will. Oh, if I do this, I feel that it has to be pure for me, and that's how I focus it.
Well, it's a brilliant work,
Thank you.
And I think people will be watching this for years to come, and we will all learn how to dance from Drake. future generations.
That'll be an interesting effect.
This was shot in a studio.
Yeah, Revival here in Toronto.
Here in Toronto.
Toronto production.
Right, it's fantastic. We're gonna wrap our. A portion up here, so thank you very much.
Thank
Director
you for
X.
having me.
We're gonna open it up to you. All right.
And for Cameron Bailey and his socks. That's style, baby. Come on now, don't front on Cameron. You play games.
All right, we've got microphones. A lot of people are gonna want to ask questions. We'll go right here first. Go ahead.
Hello?
Yes.
Hey, how are you?
I'm good.
I'm good too. I'm a bit nervous standing up especially, but
Don't worry, everyone's watching you.
Yeah, I know. That's exactly why I'm nervous.
No pressure.
I'm freaking out. My heart's going to jump out of my body.
I'm sure this will be the best question of the night, though.
Well, you better get ready. I just wanted to thank you quickly because especially all you've done for Canadian cinema is amazing.
Thank you.
And what you're going to do is also amazing.
Thank you very much. Don't jinx it, man. Someone knock on wood.
Yeah, no, for sure. I just want to refer back to, I watched a quick interview of you, I think it was like a year ago or something, and you were talking about how you used to carry around I think a tape of your reel in your backpack.
Yes.
And you said, show your reel to anyone and everyone whenever you have the chance.
Yep.
So I kind of want to ask you if you have a spare minute after the talk.
Let's hook that up. But honestly, look, if we got a moment, I will look, but you should be showing everybody and anybody. So what he's talking about, back in those days, I had that poetry video in my backpack. Back in the days when hip-hop was all about backpacks, my backpack was a mobile art studio. I had X-Acto knives, glue, art sketches, everything I needed. I could make a flyer on the spot. $20.
$20?
$20, maybe. But in there, so I had all that stuff, and I had my videotape. Mm-hmm. And I'd show you. Again, part of being young is, you know, you can walk into someone's office and be like, can I show you something? And they'll be like, oh, okay, kid, show me. You know what I'm saying? And if it's any good, they're like, oh, all right. And at the best, it'll be like, you're the greatest, and I want to get, you know, and then at least, I remember I showed Puff, and I was waiting for the moment, right? Mm-hmm. Like, here you go. This is when he's going to want me to be. And he's like, oh, cool, what's your name? All right, cool. That's what I got. So, you know, not everything's going to be the shake the ground awesome moment, but keep the hustle going, baby.
Okay, we'll go over here. Yes.
This is going to be a funny follow-up question. First of all, thank you as well, and for also being a real human, a well-rounded person, in addition to being very talented.
Most of the directors are reptilian aliens. Part of the Illuminati, because we didn't talk about the Illuminati.
We're not supposed to talk about the Illuminati.
Well, you're all members now that you came. We got membership cards for everybody. Welcome to the club. There's a guidebook for all the visuals we'll be making for 2017. Anyways, goat's heads are the things.
My question is, I'm curious to hear what you think the emerging talent is. In addition to that guy, I guess.
I mean, right, there you go. I mean, there's a lot of great talent. I've just recently been watching a lot of videos. Karina, what's that video with, yes, do you know the director's name? You know, the one with like the visuals are crazy. You gotta see this thing. It's really about two young kids. Kids Studios, are they local? Amazing. You got to see, unreal. Just so many visuals are flying at you. It's two kids having their first, maybe, moment, right? They're at the house together, you know, young teenagers, and then, you know, and it's all these analogies and visuals for sex and two kids having sex, and it's unbelievable. And what's the name of the studio?
Kid Studio.
Yeah. So, yeah, cool. Kid Studio, my all favorite.
Right. There you go.
Yeah. And the video is called what? Somewhere Else. Yeah, you'll there's animation and two kids having sex, but
not actual kids.
Visual metaphors. Right. Visual metaphors for teenage sex. It's amazing.
Yes.
Yo, question. What up, X?
What's going
on? How you doing, Cameron? My question to you is, now that you're moving into feature filmmaking, what do you want to see on screen, or what do you want to put out there in terms of whether it be genres or stories? I'm just curious.
Me, I have different interests, you know, like the death of the sun. You get a bit of my science nerd me, right? So the projects that I'm working on, I got a kid film that I'm working on. I have, you know, an action movie. I have a period drama. I have a small independent thing. So my interests vary quite a bit. And just like death, like you say, oh yeah, Director X has done a giant art sculpture of the sun. You'd be what? my feature projects and my interests are pretty varied as well.
Is that going to take up more of your time now, doing feature films and art projects?
Yes, yes. Yeah. Very, very focused on the future and building a new portfolio.
Okay. Over here.
Hello. I was wondering if there was any point in your creative career when you wanted to give up. And if so, what changed for you and what breakthrough did you have that made you continue going when you were knocking down doors?
All right, so I think I touched on it a bit about this horrible video I did. So I did this video before I read on my books. I did a video for Tracy Lee featuring Pirate MC and Busta Rhymes. And I can't, it's a remix to this record.
Party time.
Huh?
Party time.
And I do this video and it's a disaster. I got walked all over. It's just horrible, horrible, and I knew it. When I did it, it was interesting. I took the train to set, and then they called me a car. It was like a limo that took me back to my place. But I'm completely in the dumps because I completely messed up. And like I said, I'm here to be good at this. I don't want to just really want to be good. And I come back and I talk to two people. I called Alan Ferguson, who's now married to Solange, and who's Cranes in the Sky video and all that stuff. He's a director of photography that worked with Hype, so we had a relationship. And I called him, and he gave me these this is with the light and the Kino flow, and you can put this, and he kind of gave me this technical stuff. And then I spoke to Hype, and Hype was like, listen, man, that feeling you have right now, that feeling that you suck, is the enemy, and you can't listen to it. You got to battle through that. And that was the advice. You got to fight through that feeling that you're not good enough and just barrel through, because it's not true. And those two pieces of advice really shaped things, and kind of it was a turning point. Because if it went well, I would have been like, oh, well, I know everything I need to know. But it was sometimes you need to fall to realize that you're doing something wrong. And then that's when I went out and I got the books and I started devouring every book I could. And then the next job I got was this really tiny little job from Def Jam. They gave me a couple $1,000 to shoot a promo for Cormega. And as I'm in there, I remember like I pointed a light and go, scrim that light. And I go, I said that. And I'm right.
That's right. Like when Keanu says, I know Kung Fu. Suddenly
yes, exactly.
You knew
yeah,
what to do,
it was
right?
Exactly that moment.
Yes. All right, couple more. Somebody right here? Yep, go ahead. Yes, microphone.
Hey, X. My question would be pretty simple. Where do you get all this creativity from? Because, you know, you were doing installation, TV, music videos, films. So from artist to artist, like, where do you get it from?
I think you really need to be connected. And like, especially earlier, you step out and step in. I'm always watching videos. I had people who thought were doing great music videos. I was going through fashion photography. You know, I love anime and I love comics and just being in a creative space. And now I'm kind of getting back into who's doing. It's harder to find now in the music video internet age. Great work that you know. There's no one curating for you, so now you got to go hunt for it and finding people that are doing interesting work. So watching what's going on right now, remaining true to the stuff you love, looking at some classics, go to wherever, just getting in. When I'm really around art, I feel like I'm walking in nature. I get that same feeling I get if I'm in the forest or something.
Are there any particular artists that inspire you especially, or filmmakers?
Grant Singer, who does a lot of stuff at The Weeknd, he's really, really great. Okay. Melina does amazing stuff. What's the new kid? Kid Studio. Mm-hmm. I've loved those guys for a long time. Okay. Yeah, I just told this guy about Kid Studio. I put him on. there's good stuff out there.
Okay. Yes, over here. Yeah.
Hi. I just want to say I really appreciate your anecdote about Vibe because I interned there when I was 19.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
So there you go.
My question is, with the viewership that you've built and the voice that you've built as an artist through music, do you feel that you have a social responsibility to your viewers as an artist?
There are times when I think we gotta be careful. There's a part, I've had this discussion. So as an artist, the first responsibility is to be true and express the art that's coming through. I think there's a time as an artist, there's an interesting book called Understanding Comics. I know it sounds random, but in this book, Understanding Comics, he goes through and breaks down all the steps an artist takes. And at the very top, he says, you have to make a choice. You're either going to make art for art. This is art about art, right? Everyone's painted purple, and I'm going to hang them upside down, and we're going to throw paint at them. And it's, you know what I mean? It's just a visual, artistic statement. Or you're going to do art about society. Right, you can do art with a statement, and the two can't mix, but this is the top level of art. You're saying something about the world with your art, or you're saying something just about art, and when you start trying to make both of them the same, it gets confused, and people don't know what they're looking at. So there's that element to it. But on an anecdote level, I remember I got a job from, Puff called me, we had some video to do. He had some song with Beanie Man, it was Wyclef and Elephant Man, and something about getting your gun, and the hook, and Puff was like doing the hook. And I text him that, this is just after the trial. And I'm like, bro, you just narrowly escaped this. You can't be telling people in a music video to get your gun, shoot, whatever the gun lyric was. Mm-hmm. But then I signed this is back in the two-way pager days, I signed my signature and I put in a Bible verse from Proverbs, a wise man listens to advice, something along those
lines. Wow. Just underline.
Underline, because people put quotes. Yeah. I'm like, oh, my quote this time will be Proverbs, whatever. The wise man listens to advice, a fool forsakes, or whatever, whatever. Yeah. And he didn't show up in the video. Maybe, I don't know if Elephant Man will be happy to hear that. But it was, sometimes you do need to say, this ain't quite right, guys. Uh-huh. This might not be the best scene to shoot.
Okay. We're gonna have to make this the last question. We're unfortunately just about out of time, so right here.
Two-part question. What is your favorite part of the production process, and what do you think is the most overlooked or like underappreciated part of the creative production process?
I mean, I love every part of it. I love filmmaking. I love being in the 15-pass van, going to locations, trading stories. I like being in the edit. I like shooting on set. Mm. I love every single part of the production process. There's no part that's better than the other. Maybe the best part is when they say you booked the job. that's an awesome part. But really, in general, every part of it is amazing, and I love that. Yeah. What's the most overlooked part of the filmmaking process?
We haven't talked about editing, and I know your editor is here today.
Laura,
people often don't see that.
Say hi. You can wave your hand. The girl, right, blonde with the two. There you go. She caught Hotline Bling. She caught Rihanna work. And,
Not overlooked anymore.
Not overlooked anymore. Yeah.
We are going to have to wrap it up, unfortunately. This has been terrific. Thank you so much, X.
Thank you.
Please join me in thanking once again Director X.
And Cameron Bailey.
Thank you, man. Thank you.